Hello and welcome to this special program on NewsX. I'm Uday Pratap Singh. A special panel discussion on 1 year of the demonetization exercise which was carried out by the Narendra Modi government exactly 365 days ago. Joining us today are prominent citizens of the country. We have Rasil Gujral Ansal joining us. She's of course the co-founder of Casa Paradox and Casa Pop. Naveen Ansal, who's also co-founder of the same luxury home interior and design company, joins us as well. Gucharan Das, author and founder, former CEO rather, of Procter & Gamble, is also with us on the program. A leading light who's actually been talking a lot about this issue, of course, and other pressing issues concerning the economy of our country. So if I can begin with you first, Mr. Ansal, what went through your mind on November the 8th in 2016 when it was announced, and how were the days to follow? It was something momentous, the challenges, of course, of which the entire country saw and faced. But what went through your mind about the demonetization exercise?
Thank you. I was, when this happened on the 8th of November last year, I was driving either back home or going from home somewhere. And it came out as a shock from the blue because, firstly, I didn't understand what they were trying to do. Secondly, to do something like this, without any sort of information out in the open, one was confused that what was happening, what were they trying to do, what is going to happen now, because it was impossible to understand what they were trying to do. So I was confused and I was a little bewildered as to what the whole situation was and how would they make it apparent that after 12 o'clock that night, there'd be no money in the markets. So it was something that was not something that I could fathom too easily.
Let's quickly get in Gucharan Das at that point. Gucharan Das, when you first heard the announcement, what were your initial readings, perceptions, reactions to this exercise?
Well, in the beginning, I frankly bought some of the rhetoric about the benefits of reducing the cash economy. I saw the benefits of enhanced taxes, less black money, all these, and moving much more into digital payments, etc. So all these were positives. A year from now?
Yeah. Hindsight. Yes.
Hindsight. I think it was a mistake. I think there will be benefits. There will be significant long-term benefits. Even people who complain that 99% has come back, so what have you achieved? You've actually brought back a lot of cash, that will be now in the formal economy, which can be lent in the formal economy. So you will have formalized a lot of economy.
Yes.
And you will have an audit trail for lots of people who were not paying taxes, etc. But, frankly, was the pain worth it? We really created not only the pain of long queues, waiting in line for days and days, but also people have lost their jobs in the informal economy. I mean, last quarter our GDP growth rate dropped to 5.7%.
But Rasil Gujral, Ansal, come in here. On what you thought of the whole exercise, hindsight, etc. as well. And then I'll also come to, how it impacted you in your, in clients and customers, etc., coming to you as well. This new, focus on digital transactions. But first, hindsight and your observations.
Well, I don't think any long-term benefit or any long-term operation can be implemented with an overnight policy. I feel the manner in which the demonetization was announced and sort of there was like an overnight reaction into as to how you were supposed to conduct your business was unrealistic. And as we all are largely aware, we are an adaptable people. especially in the business environment, you adapt. You don't have a choice, because in order to survive, you have to adapt. We employ a lot of craft people, semi-skilled and skilled people. These people do not necessarily either understand or have capacity to want to assimilate to be part of the digital India. And to expect to have done that overnight was very harsh. I mean, the people who are supposedly the elite and the higher income group can always manage. We have people who will go and stand in your queues for you. We have credit that stores will give you. You buy a lot of things online. So our daily lives were not impacted. But the staff who was not living in Malis, semi-skilled workers, other sort of job work kind of people, their lives were paralyzed. We did not have money to loan them, because they said, we can't get credit in the shop to buy our groceries. Forget standing in a queue. So it was like we were in a time of war when we should not have been, you know. So I felt it was, yes, I think all the policies, whether it is demonetization or whether it is GST or whatever else that the government might think are progressive ideas, are all ideas that need to be brought into the system in a very gradual manner.
For business per se, what needs to be done now? You know, because we need to end on an optimistic note.
Yeah.
But Gurcharan Das also saying that at the end of the day, you can't just blame the NDA government, you know, for the low GDP numbers, because the previous government also, while growth was still at a certain figure, did not capitalize on what was left behind earlier. So what is needed now for sentiment?
See, I'm not an economist, and nor am I too well informed about what steps should be taken by the government. But I can certainly say one thing, that the pessimism in the economy, in the market, in every sphere that is at the moment all around us, that needs to change.
The criticism is that the private sector is not investing. And the answer is a very simple one. You invest when there's demand. If you have customers, you'd be a fool not to invest in inventory, in capital investment, etc. So really, the issue is demand.
No, that's a valid point, and there are, of course, crucial elections around the corner. So that is a piece of advice of Gurcharan Das for the government. Stay with us. We're opening this up to more panelists.
Rare developments are taking place. The Prime Minister to address the country tonight.
Hello everyone, and welcome to this special roundtable on demonetization on NewsX. Around a year ago, Prime Minister Narendra Modi stunned the entire country as he announced the demonetization. Was there a doctor in the demonetization, or was there a demon? Was there a devil, or was it a detoxification of the economy? Well, to discuss and deliberate on this subject, I have a distinguished panel with me. Prakash Belwadi, actor, writer, activist, and next to him is Priya Chetty Rajagopal, CXO of Search Consultants, and then we have MP Shyam, entrepreneur, industrialist, and automobile giant. Well, this entire demonetization has, in fact, unleashed a kind of anxiety in the entire country. While Prakash, I want to take your pick on this. What was your initial reaction, and then a year down the lane, how do you think it has impacted the country, and personally, what do you have to say about this?
Frankly, I was shocked when I first heard of this extraordinary exercise where about 85% of the currency in the economy is pulled out. But I must confess that I continue to support demonetization, with the disclaimer that, you know, I'm not a businessman, I'm an artist. So the pain I felt because of demonetization was very little, because together I think between my wife and I, we had about 8,500 rupees in the house. And we didn't feel too much pain. I think I was in a lot of trouble for my wife because I kept borrowing money from her to commute in the city and stuff like that. But we didn't feel. The reasons I supported, I will state at the outset, I'm saying there was a real problem in this country. Why such an upheaval happened during the 2014 elections was that we wanted, a number of people in this country wanted big change. And we couldn't take status quo anymore. And somebody who meant well, with good intent, who was patriotic, who cared for the country and its people, and believed in its future, had to take some drastic steps. So on that ground itself, I supported it, because we cannot take status quo. And there was going to be some downsides to this, you know, and some negative impact, because it is too big a move, and it was going to hurt a lot of people. And it did, I guess. But while not saying, you know, that I don't know whether it was avoidable or not, I don't think there's so much talent in this government or the previous government where you could have calculated every risk and done it much better. I don't know if you could have done. But the thing is, it was done for big change, and it's important to think that it's going to have a positive impact long term. I know many economists have said that too. Where do we wait? It's too early to make a decision whether it worked or not.
Priya, your first initial reactions on demonetization, what did you feel? And then you're down. Does the feeling same persist?
You know, the day I heard about it, I was on a flight to Singapore, and we had a very different context at that time. The steel flyover was a large part of what Bangalore was fighting for. So we felt that it would be a big, you know, sort of a blow to the reasons why the flyover was happening in the first place. So I would say very naively that the first reaction was euphoria, saying, oh good, we've done something which has been, which is required, which is certainly something dramatic and impactful for the long term. And it's a very bold move. However, over a period of time, I think certainly there has been, we are all human beings, we've seen what really happened, we saw what was reported in the media, however, you know, sort of colored it was or not. I think the reality of the way demonetization was handled continued to be a major concern. I also hide behind two different curtains. One is being boringly middle class and being boringly law-abiding. And secondly, being of the standard corporate suit. Really, that's where I come from. Now, on both grounds, we're very, very, very untouched. You know, we are digital, we're well-educated. We're also pretty much follow the letter of the law, you know. So I think that part of it made me feel a little sad, because we were very insulated. As a middle class, I think as the educated middle class, it really was a good thing. As a corporate, it didn't really affect us. The B2B section, to which I belong, business to business really wasn't so heavily impacted. The B2C, which was so heavily based on consumers, definitely took a hit, and definitely business that required more liquid money, like, you know, jewelry and more luxury purchases, definitely were affected. But that, I don't think it's required to go in there. Let's just step back and, you know, once again come at this from a point of view of having started something and completing it. Let's assume I don't love what you do, but you are an accepted leader and we follow. It's important for us to be able to make sure it succeeds. As a large population, as part of the team, we have to make sure it succeeds. Or as, you know, we were talking about just before this, it's very easy to let something implode rather than make it succeed. So right now, in terms of making it succeed, have we really reached there? I really don't know.
As from a business perspective, not only from the automobile industry, there is fewer liquidity. And we're also given to understand that spending has reduced. People have stopped spending. And once they've gotten their currency, they started storing it at home. They're not, you know, moving out the cash. What are the kind of experiences, what were the high point, what are the low point during this demonetization period?
One of the good things is, all these years in the country, compliance and, what must I say, respecting the law has been very low in our country. This particular Prime Minister, Mr. Modi, has shown not only the country but the entire world that I want India to be a much better compliant country. terms of compliance. And I want people to be more honest, you know, pay your taxes, come out clean. I want to bring down corruption in public life. He sincerely has tried his best at it, you know, like both my colleagues were telling, that what is good for the nation is good for the people of this country. I think his sincerity and patriotism is something that I wouldn't even doubt him for that. People have gone through pains, like any major decision that you take, you go through a lot of pain, a lot of upheaval. But things have settled down. People have got used to it. There were long queues in front of ATMs, there were long queues in front of banks. But it's like Priya was telling, it's all a story of the past. Things have settled down and it's business as usual.
Well, notwithstanding the shortcomings, demonetization has got a thumbs up from my panelists. Thank you all for joining me on this show. And it looks like Modi has got a plan. There is GST, then there is going after the Benami properties. So he's got plans on his mind, and then it's going to pan out. Entire country is watching how Indian economy will grow under his leadership. Thanks for watching.
They're known as the 5th anniversary of Indian economy.
This market is very optimistic about
it. Last 3 months se jo used to ho rahe hain, ye acha hai.
Customer bilkul bazaar mein nahi raha.
It's November 8th, 1 year since demonetization in India, and we have a few leading entrepreneurs and businessmen who are joining us on the show today to talk about this. Welcome to the show. Dr. Kumar, Managing Director of Naveen, Suman Thraman, Political Analyst, Mr. Sudarshan, Vice President of Kevin Care, and Mr. Sabesan, CFO of Dr. Agarwals. Welcome to the show once again, gentlemen. Dr. Kumar, how has demonetization affected real estate sector in India?
The first 2 months has been pretty bad. People were standing in queues, trying to make their, you know, small cashes from the banks. And it has affected completely. Their sales were down almost to nil. But afterwards, it started slowly picking up. I would say the real estate is already affected by the economic slowdown, and then later by the RERA and the GST. But the impact of demonetization in the organized real estate sector, you'll have to differentiate between the organized and the unorganized real estate. The impact of demonetization has been for those 2 months. Afterwards, it has slowly tapered off. That's my view.
Okay, so since the last 1 year, where is it today? Where does it stand today in the 1 year anniversary?
I think the impact of demonetization is almost forgotten. Except in probably the tier 2, tier 3 cities where the cash transactions could be a little more, and the land transactions. Otherwise, in the organized real estate sector where the buying public go for 80% bank loans, I think it has not made any difference. Probably because the market is already depressed, we don't see much of a difference also, we can say.
Okay. Mr. Sudarshan, what about the FMCG sector? Do you think that there was a lot of impact on it? Has it bounced back to where it was before?
Yeah, to put it in a simple term, I could say that this is a smaller pain for a larger gain. So initially, even though the entire sector got impacted for first couple of months, and later on it has completely tapered down, and today we are the whole issue is behind us. Of course, the other issues like GST are there haunting now. Again, that is also another pain. We call it as a correction mode. So once the corrections are made, we can also always make a huge gain in the later period. So initially, we will say that there used to be a slowdown in the growth for the first month. Subsequent months, it tapered down. And now industry is back to normal. We don't find any issues, at least because of the demonetization. And the one big gain which we are foreseeing for the industry is that, you know, there used to be a lot of parallel economy and, no bill transactions which used to be happening. Now, again, the ingenious mind is still there with the Indians in the MSME sector, and a lot of people are still pursuing that. But still, at least the intent is now coming back to doing transaction with proper bills. Perhaps thanks to the demonetization, the digital transactions have picked up, and thanks to the GST, the bills are being cut, though not 100%. And maybe a beginning has commenced towards that.
Mr. Sabeesan, what about the the hospital, the healthcare industry? How has it impacted? Has it impacted at all, if I can ask?
Like some of my other panelists were saying, the short-term impact definitely all of us felt at the individual level. Similarly, the industry also went through it. But the silver lining that I could say was, being in healthcare, probably a denomination cannot be a constraint for somebody getting a treatment. So we saw a lot of human side coming out. I mean, we were corporates, we were still able to afford. But we also saw a lot of this in the neighborhood where doctors were willing to look at people who didn't have the ready currency. So we started adapting to accepting other forms of payment. So I think the human touch came out. I think probably the individual's good quality started coming out. So that was one short-term silver lining that I saw. But like my colleague was saying, after 2-3 months, we started adopting. It was business as usual. The good side, the digital economy took over the cash economy. There's a lot more transparency, less of currency being handled, a lot of operational convenience. We started looking at adapting new technology and, probably adapting to the changes that we are trying to bring in. The positive side was what I think we saw in the industry.
So, Sumanth, what is your take on all this, on the demonetization drive?
Okay, if we start off by looking at the original objectives, and the objectives have evolved over time. So, the objective one was obviously to curb the black money. The second objective, which was stated, was to fight terrorism. And the third objective was to, do away with counterfeiting. Now, clearly, at least on 2 and 3, we know that there hasn't been any major impact, at least from whatever statistics are put out. Though there are claims that, some Maoist areas, the level of violence is down and so on. But beyond that, there is really no clear evidence that there's been a huge impact on terrorism. Also, the same is the case with counterfeiting. But even now, we see this 2,000 rupee note fakes are picked up here and there. So, which brings us to the question of black money. Obviously, there has been a slowdown in the generation of black money. Now, the question is demonetization going to continue to be the reason why black money economy does not emerge? I don't think so. If anything, GST is probably going to be play a bigger role in curbing black money than demonetization. Some of my panelists were saying, the fact that in the small and medium sector, the kind of no-bill transactions have again started in the economy, now that again is a worrying sign. In fact, one of the economists I was speaking to was actually saying, once the black money economy actually picks up, then the economy will again go back to what it was, which is not actually the objective of demonetization in the first place. But across the board, if you talk to traders, you are getting the feeling that slowly, there is some improvement. Now, how long it's going to take for us to go back to the pre-demonetization levels? Because there was already a slowdown. As Mr. Kumar said, there was already a slowdown in the economy even before demonetization, and then GST hit it. So it served as a kind of double whammy. Objective-wise, we were told 3 lakh crores wouldn't come back into the system, and RBI would have a windfall. Now, almost all the money came back. So now what do? We say that, okay, we're going to collect a lot of taxes. Now, when are we going to collect these taxes? That again is up in the air, because this is going to go through litigation for years. So I think overall, if you look at it, whether the price we have paid, now GST, I would entirely agree, is worth it. I mean, the rates may be wrong, the implementation may be messy, all of that. But in the long run, I don't think there's anybody in this country who will say GST is not required. On the other hand, I think the view on demonetization is mixed. I do believe at this point of time, the consensus would probably be saying that it's probably not achieved the objectives that it set out to do.
It was wonderful speaking to all of you. So like our panelists said, demonetization was a good move, but the MSME sector has to be looked at and focused on, and incentives need to be provided for the people as well to take it forward positively. Thank you so much. Thank you for joining us today.
Adopt the new notes and do the business.
1 year now, so now things have been moving.
After 1 year also, the impact is quite valuable.
It's a noble move, but it will take time for the people to imbibe.
the government should give more incentive.
The most affected people were the tourists.
The Indian calling it a surgical strike against black money.
Demonetization led to e-monetization in several parts.